Good morning, Cedar Lane, and welcome to Music and Message. I am so glad that you joined us for this special time of worship. I hope that through it, you will be strengthened for the journey ahead, and you will have the chance to celebrate our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as we lift our hearts in song and prayer and in hearing the word. Let's worship. As we pray today, I know you have many concerns. I do too. I want you to know that God hears you when you speak, when you pray. And God loves it when we pray together. So let's do that right now. Let's pray. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We celebrate him. But we confess we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by ways that lead to death. We come asking you to forgive our sin and eradicate evil in the world. By your word and spirit, purify the good and raise us from death to life, more abundant and free. Transform us into faithful followers of Jesus Christ, the one who rules the world and is head of the church, the one who has freed us to live in you, the one who has brought healing and strength into the world, the one who we without fear may rest in his hands, those that are on our hearts. So right now we lift their names before you. Thank you for hearing our prayers. And now in one spirit as brothers and sisters, we pray together the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today I want to read to you from 1 Corinthians 15, the 12th through the 20th verses. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But if he did not raise him, if in fact the dead are not raised, for if the dead are not raised, then Christ was not raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life, we have hope in Christ. We are all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. You know, Paul's never been one to beat around the bush. And eventually he gets right down to what it's about, the brass tacks. What is it about? And sometimes that makes his hearers squirm. Sometimes it makes us squirm to hear him do that. And so there's this debate in the church at Corinth, apparently, that has to do with resurrection of the dead. And that's why Paul takes time to itemize this, to look at this argument and say, wait a minute, you know, it follows last week's test where he asked the church to hold firmly to their faith that what was proclaimed from the beginning, and for Paul was part of the original proclamation, was the resurrection of Jesus as the first fruits. Now, first fruits is a term that was usually used for sacrifice. We offer to God the first fruits of the harvest, the first fruits of the flock. It refers to the best, the prime, taking the best off the top before anything else. So Jesus was the first fruits of those who have died. And so, you know, when we made those offerings, when those offerings were made, they were made from the sweat of our brow and the labor of our hands and the toil of our backs, that we worked and we gave the best to God. And so there's an element of reasoning God, and Paul using that phrase, You know, because Christ is indeed the best that this world, that this flesh has to offer to the divine, to the Holy One, to God. Christ is the only offering. He's the best offering. There's no better offering than who Christ was. And so Paul isn't using that as a means of setting Christ apart from us, but rather he is saying that he is the sacrifice and the offering of Christ as an example for us and a promise for us as well, to know that we too are called to live a life that is in belief and in the strength of the resurrection. And so as we look at Christ as that initial sacrifice, you know, when he talked about living and inviting us into that more excellent way we talked about in 1 Corinthians 13, you know, what more can we live than that excellent way, that the way of love, true love, that helps us to deal with things and helps us to work through kind of the things that hold us up and tie us back in our lives, because it's incredible the petty things that take us down. When if we let the high road in realizing that Christ truly did die for us, that we might be free, I think that the petty things wouldn't have that much control on us. But boy, they seem to. So Jesus is the first fruits, and he's the example. I mean, he is the example as the resurrection. And so as he was raised, so will we be raised. So if we don't believe that he was raised, then how in the world can we believe that we'll be raised? So without that concept, we're bearing false testimony. Without knowing that there is a resurrection, that Christ was resurrected, and that there is a resurrection of the dead, then really the thing that it's futile to live the way that we try to live. Is what we're doing just something that we do because everybody else has done it? Or do we truly live and embody the fact that Christ died and Christ rose that we might be free, and specifically realizing that we will have true life because of what happened in his life and in his death and in his resurrection? So, you know, if you want to think about that, it's a pretty powerful thought. And it's amazing how, you know, I really and truly this week was not going to talk about death at all, just because it seems like I've been talking about that. And, you know, it's hard for me not to talk about that. I remember when Elizabeth was born, I preached the night that Elizabeth was born at a community service. And I thought I did an excellent job with the gospel. But by the time it was over with, it sounds like I might have talked more about her being born than I talked about the gospel that night. And it was Holy Week, and there was plenty to talk about. And the same thing, you know, with the things that I've been through in the last little bit, and some of us, others of us have been through and with death. But there is no better thing to know than this way of excellence that is talked about in 1 Corinthians 13, which seems like the thing you would want to talk about before Valentine's Day. That way of love is empowered, is enabled, is impossible without resurrection. Without the true faith that gives us strength, without the faith that we cling to, knowing that this life is not all, and we live for this life and beyond. And so today we celebrate that, and we think about that excellent way, 1 Corinthians 13, but we celebrate that Jesus as first fruits provided a way for us to live that excellent way. He showed us what love truly was, that love was not an easy thing. It was not a trivial thing. It was not just like a little trinket thing. It was a deep giving love, a love that gave his life for us, a love that gave us life. And it's time for us to live in that. With that said, I pray my blessings upon you. Blessing for God to touch your life, touch your hearts, and help you to know that there is truly love in this world, and to know that there is truly resurrection for your life. There is life after this life. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. We get so captivated by this world that we forget that we're living for a world that we can't even describe, but we do know that it's there because Jesus promised us that. Help us to live in that promise. Help us to share that promise with anyone who will listen. And help us to do it in a way that doesn't make us look pompous, but makes you look loving and graceful and the giver of peace. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we conclude our time together today, I want to thank you for joining us for Music and Message. And if you look back through the files, you'll see that we have done a ton of them since the pandemic began, and we'll continue to do them. We are hoping and praying that things get more normal soon. And in that light, we are watching the numbers. We will continue to have Music and Message, but we'll also be meeting on Sundays at 11, as we have been. We've had a couple of times where the numbers have gotten exceedingly high and we've taken off. But also, we have Sunday school in person and also via Zoom. If you would like to participate in Sunday school, send us a direct message and we will send you the link to be able to come into the Zoom class and be a part of that. Also, it is in person and it's in the fellowship hall every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. You're invited. I hope you have a great week and we'll talk soon.